Well, I am honored to be back here at Harvest, and thank you for being here. There's a lot of places that there are a lot of places that you could be today, and there's a lot of churches where you could worship. And I just want to personally say thank you that you're here at Harvest. When I was a youngster, my dad found out very early that I enjoyed telling jokes and I enjoyed making people laugh. So when I was about 5 years old, he pulled me aside and he said, hey, he said, what if you and I worked up something that we could do together? Because every once in a while he'd give me a one-liner, and so I'm like, okay, all right, I can try to learn something. And so if a party was going rather slow, he would kind of pull me out from the wings and we would do this comedy dialogue. I was about 5 years old at the time, and he'd say, okay, let's go for it. I'd say, all right. I'd say, Dad would say, hey, Dave, did you hear about what happened to Bill? And I say, oh, no, Dad, what happened to Bill? Well, Bill fell out of an airplane. I'd say, oh, that's bad. He'd say, no, he had a parachute on. I say, oh, that's good. He said, no, the parachute didn't open. I said, oh, that's bad. He said, no, there was a haystack directly underneath where he was falling. I said, oh, that's good. He said, no, there was a pitchfork in the haystack. I said, oh, that's bad. He said, no, he missed the pitchfork. I said, that's good. He said, no, he missed the haystack too. I said, oh, that's bad. And you are saying right now, oh, that's really bad, right? In five decades, my humor has not improved, evidently, but there's a lot of truth to that story, because if you think about your own life, there are a lot of ups and downs. There's a lot of, oh, that's good moments, and there's a lot of, oh, that's bad moments as well. And that's kind of what you have been experiencing and enduring in the life of Harvest in recent days. You go back last few months, and there have been some great mountaintops. There was the 30th anniversary events and the big celebration that took place. And you say, oh, that's good. But then things go a little bit sideways somewhere along the line, and you learn that your senior pastor is no longer your preacher. And you say, oh, that's bad. But then the next week, you have over 1,200 junior high and high school kids coming here for the wake-up conference, and decisions for Christ are made, and you say, oh, that's good. And then a few days later come the resignations of a couple of brothers who dearly love this church and who will be sorely missed, and you say, oh, that's bad. And sometimes it seems that the mountaintops and the valleys are all we have, and there's very little in between. And for this stretch that you find yourselves in right now, you'd have to say that there have been more, oh, that's bad moments than there have been, oh, that's good. There have been more pitchforks than haystacks. I'm going to invite you, though, to turn in your Bible to the Old Testament book of Daniel. So take your Bible out, if you would. And if you don't have one with you, there's one right in front of you. Or if you like, look in your mobile device and find Daniel chapter 3. And this book of Daniel has a whole lot of ups and downs in it. And you'll find several stories in this short book with bad things happening. But I want to encourage you that throughout the book of Daniel, you will see that somehow God orchestrates a good ending to each of these stories. And one of them is found in Daniel 3. So I hope at every campus that you are just following along and you're in the Word, you probably know a little bit about the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel has four main characters in it. Daniel has the leading role. And then there are three guys also who have a supporting role. Their names are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And in fact, every single time that their names are mentioned, it's always mentioned in a group. You don't find one by itself. They're all three mentioned together. They're inseparable. They're linked together. And because of Israel's unfaithfulness, God had allowed the army of Babylon to besiege the city of Jerusalem and to take the Hebrews captive. And so the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, had a number of the young, intelligent, handsome young Jewish men placed into special training there in Babylon where he had taken them. So now they would be serving him. Now they would be serving his kingdom. And Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were four of the young men who were chosen. Now, Daniel isn't mentioned in chapter 3, and most people think that he was probably away on an assignment on behalf of the king. But King Nebuchadnezzar, you have to understand, he was an unpredictable pagan ruler, and he was very self-absorbed, and he was a huge proponent of idol worship. And so he sought to indoctrinate these young Jewish men, and he wanted to do anything he possibly could to teach them the Babylonian ways. And for some unknown reason, King Nebuchadnezzar had a golden image made. It probably was a male ego trip, to be honest with you. It was 9 feet wide. It was 90 feet high. And so everyone could see it. It was 9 stories. It was huge. And idol-worshiping Babylonians set it up on the plain of Dura, and they had a big dedication service. And so everyone came out there. There were all the political leaders. There were all the religious leaders. There were citizens that were all there from Babylon. In fact, they estimate that it was probably around 300,000 people that came out for this dedication service. And Nebuchadnezzar had a decree read at that service for this monument. Look in your Bible, Daniel chapter 3, verses 4 through 6. And the herald proclaimed aloud, "You are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, you are to fall down and worship the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be cast into a burning, fiery furnace." So now every Jewish person who has been brought there has a decision to make. Do I reject my godly heritage? Do I step in line with the cultural beliefs of those who have taken me captive? Well, the music played and everyone worshiped. All the Babylonians, all the Jewish people, except for 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And when a group of thousands of people all fall to their knees and 3 of them don't, it kind of stands out a little, right? And so the king's men brought it to the king's attention, and they play to his ego, saying that this is an affront to his authority. Look in your Bible at verse 12. They're talking to the king. "There are certain Jews whom you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, pay no attention to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." Now, this was not done in secret. It was a bold expression of the New Testament statement that we must obey God rather than men. And that's the way Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego approached it. They would not bow down. They were acquainted with the Ten Commandments. They knew they weren't supposed to worship an idol. So rather than bow, in their lives, it was a time for them to stand. And that's where we start on your outline or on your note page. We stand in public. We stand in public. The Christian life was not meant to be lived alone in seclusion. Your classmates at school are watching you. Your family wants to see what's distinctive about you and your faith. Your coworkers are curious to see whether you really are a person of integrity and you're walking the talk that you preach. There will always be people watching who have an agenda that is different than yours. And King Nebuchadnezzar ruled with an iron fist. He was an able general who reigned for 40 years, and get this, he never lost a battle. He had not lost one battle. And when he hears that someone didn't bow down, he is ticked. And I mean, he is hacked off. Look back in your Bible, verses 13 through 15. "Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought. So they brought these men before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, 'Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set up? Now, if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, to fall down and worship the image that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning, fiery furnace.'" And get this, "And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands. Evidently, he doesn't know the power of the one and only God. The gods that he's speaking of are lower G, not the capital G God. But we will learn, secondly, that we stand when pressured. We stand when pressured. The king resorts to intimidation. He basically says, you know, I'll give you a second chance. I'm a nice guy. But make certain that you understand the consequences of disobedience will be a fiery furnace. Now, you think at this point that the guys would huddle up and say, hey, let's get our heads together here. Give us 1 minute, king, all right? Let's think this over. We're 700 miles away. There's no synagogue here where we can worship. What if we did this? What if we just worshiped inside the one true God, but on the outside, we bowed down? What if, and they start going through different scenarios. I don't know if that happened. We don't really know. We know that Satan had to be whispering to them, hey, what happens in Babylon stays in Babylon. But they're not listening to Satan's whispers. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they basically say, with all due respect, O king, we're not going to bow down and worship anyone or anything but the one true living God. How are you when it comes to making the hard decisions? Where do you land? What's your process that you go through when you're kind of on the fence on something? Recently, I heard about a mom in the church where I serve. She dropped off her 13-year-old daughter at the movies. She was going to see a movie with her girlfriends. And once they got in the theater and the movie started, her girlfriend said, hey, we're going to hop over to this other theater and we're going to go in this other one and we're going to watch this. And it was an R-rated movie that was quite popular at the time. And the 13-year-old Christian said, no, I told my mom that we're coming to see this movie and we need to stay here. And the girls laughed at her and said, your mom will never know. And the girl looked back and said, you don't understand. I won't lie to my mom. And the girl's friends got up and they left and they went to the raunchy movie. And she stayed there by herself, and she sat in the theater all alone and watched that movie. When we refuse to bow, the world has its furnaces to put us in. Furnaces of scorn, furnaces of ridicule and laughter. Now, please don't misapply the fiery furnace analogy. Let me be very clear. Sometimes we are ostracized because we have taken a stand for Christ. Sometimes our trials are a consequence of living in a fallen world. Sometimes we end up in the fiery furnace due to sin in our own life. And that sin is brought out into the light. We made a poor decision, and so the consequences of those decisions are self-inflicted. And other times, it's because of the attacks of the evil one and his agenda to kill and steal and destroy. And sometimes we find ourselves in the fire because God wants to deepen our walk and refine and sharpen us. That's why when the pressure is on, we have to make the right choice. I guess it was about 15 years ago, I got a call from the father of a bride. I was doing his daughter's wedding, and he called up and said, Dave, he said, hey, we're going to have to change the date, and we're also changing the location, and I want to see if you can do it. I said, well, you know, I don't do many services at all away from church. I usually always do them at church. I don't know if I'll be able to do it. He said, well, it's in the Bahamas. I said, okay, I'm listening. All right. And so he said, my daughter really wants you to still be able to do this. And he said, now, please understand, you know, we would pay your way there. We would pay for your wife, Beth, to go with you. We would pay for a vacation for you guys, and we would put you up there. And he just went on and on. And he said, Dave, have you ever played golf in the Bahamas? I said, only on my computer. He said, I could get you on a great golf course. And the pressure now is starting to mount. And, you know, I mean, he's going for the jugular. He says, my daughter really wants you to do it. Well, I tried not to seem overly excited. But I said, hey, you know what? I might be preaching that weekend here at church. He said, I've already called. I've checked the preaching schedule. You're not preaching that weekend. I'm like, thank you. But I still tried to maintain some level of calmness and decorum. I said, you know what? I'm out of town right now. My calendar is on my desk. I'll call my assistant, and I'll call my wife, and I'll get back with you. So I called up Beth and I said, hey, we need to pray about this. And so I said, while I pray, will you start packing? And then I called my assistant and I said, will you go down to my office and take a look at my calendar? It's 15 years ago. You know, I said, it's on my desk. A couple minutes later, she comes back. She says, Dave, she said, you already have a wedding on that same day here at church. I said, well, who is it? She said the names, and I didn't know the people, and I didn't recognize the names. So now I'm faced with a decision, right? I'm faced with a choice. And I got to tell you, it's amazing how quickly options can pop in your mind of what to say. My first option was this. I thought, you know what, I can call up this couple and just say in a very deep and holy voice, well, you know what, hey, I've got a problem. I'm going to be out of town when that's going on. I'm going to be actually out of the country. And that would sound, if I said it holy enough, it would sound like a mission trip, right? So that's the first thought that went through my mind. My second thought, I'm just going to apologize before I even tell you. I'm embarrassed to even tell you the second thought that popped in my mind. But my second thought was, if I can just break this couple up. I know it sounds worse when you say it out loud. I know. But that's really what I thought. If I just can break them up, if I can call them in for some counseling and premarital counseling, and after a while I go, well, you guys are not compatible at all. What are you thinking? You know? Call this thing off. But the third choice, you know what the third choice was? Is do the right thing. To keep my word, to honor my commitments. And so that's what I did. Or else I would never be telling you the story. But that's not easy when your carnal self is arguing with you and when the Bahamas are calling your name. But each and every day, you are faced with a myriad of choices. How are you going to respond to this? What are you going to say to that person? How are you going to interact with those who have no faith and no desire to have a faith? How are you going to live out your faith without bowing down? And so when the world asks you to bow, or your friends tempt you to switch theaters, or your boss asks you to do something unethical, or you're tempted to be consumed by fear rather than walking by faith, ask God's Holy Spirit to give you the power to choose the more difficult right rather than the easier wrong. How do you respond when the pressure's on? I'm sure there were people who said to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you know what, you can be a much stronger testimony for God if you're alive rather than if you're dead. But these three Hebrew men would not alter their convictions to save their hide. They wouldn't switch theaters. They wouldn't do the wedding in the Bahamas just to fit in with the crowd. And on a daily basis, you are tempted to bow. It's not a 90-foot golden statue, mind you. But many of you will be enticed. You'll be enticed to bow down to materialism or to indulge in lust or to grow lazy in your marriage. I find it incredibly interesting that there are three friends in this story instead of two. And I wonder if at any point, once that decree was made, I wonder if there was at any moment where there was one of them that was on the fence, and yet the other two helped him. And they said, hey, we're all in this together. You know, I've got your back, you've got my back. We stay together, I'll be right here beside you. There's a really cool passage in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12. You hear it an awful lot at wedding ceremonies. I'm gonna use it in the Bahamas someday. It says, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. Ecclesiastes 4:12. At a wedding, sometimes that application is made, and it's talked about that Jesus is the third strand of that cord. And I think that's true in marriage. And I think it's accurate to say that at a wedding. I think a more accurate rendering of the passage is referring to three united friends. In other words, when you move from two believing friends to three believing friends, incredible things can happen, and you can become a formidable force, as we see here in Daniel chapter 3. But Nebuchadnezzar ruled the land, and powerful men don't like to be told no. And especially, they don't like it when their orders are totally disregarded. And if you thought that he was upset before, look in your Bible at Daniel 3, verse 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He ordered the furnace heated up 7 times more than it was usually heated. He ordered some of the mighty men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their cloaks, their tunics, their hats, their other garments, and they were thrown into the burning fiery furnace. Because the king's order was urgent and the furnace was overheated, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these 3 men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell bound into the burning fiery furnace. The entry area is so hot right there that the guys who threw them in die. That's how hot the flames were. That's how intense of a setting it was. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego made no plea for a second chance. As they were being thrown in, they didn't beg and say, hey, you know what? We've changed our mind. Here's a third takeaway for you today. We stand when persecuted. We stand when persecuted. I think we live in a time in our culture where we don't really know what it means to be persecuted for the cause of Christ. Maybe we face opposition, maybe we face ridicule, but nothing compared to the martyrs who right now in the Middle East, in Syria, in different places are giving up their lives in order to testify on behalf of Jesus Christ. How do you respond when we face American persecution? Nebuchadnezzar challenged these guys in royal fashion. Our natural tendency is to become defensive when we're opposed, to lash out. Competitive juices that we didn't even know that we had begin to surface. And how do you respond when all eyes are on you? It's lunchtime in the break room, and tomorrow the jabs will start flying. Don't you claim to be one of those Christians? Don't you go to that church that's been in the news a whole lot lately, and the news isn't real flattering? How do you respond? What do you say? Do you cower? Do you bristle up? Do you come out swinging? Or does your demeanor convey a different message? After last night's service, I was talking with some folks in the lobby, and a man came up and said, you know what, I've had to answer a lot of questions from people who know that I go to Harvest this past week. But he said, this situation has allowed me to share my faith with 2 people. Because the questions that they asked allowed me to just talk about what I believe. And while my hope is not in people, my hope is in Christ. What if you began to look at an, oh, that's bad moment as an opportunity to share your faith? 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, but in your heart set apart Christ Jesus as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do it with gentleness and with respect. Please notice these 3 didn't suddenly get moral convictions. They already had them. They had survived smaller test after test after test. They had matured and they had deepened. You remember back in Daniel chapter 1, they had refused to eat the food that the king wanted to serve to them because in their Jewish convictions, it was unclean food to them. So they already had taken a stand. But now the king thinks that he has taken care of the problem by having them die this horrific death, by throwing them in the furnace. But while the king's men are celebrating, something catches the eye of Nebuchadnezzar. Look in your Bible at verse 24. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He declared to his counselors, hey, did we not cast 3 men bound into the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. He answered and said, but I see 4 men unbound walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the appearance of the 4th is like a son of the gods. That's the only way he knew how to put it into words. It looks like God's son in there. Now stop right there for just a minute. Picture this scene. The king and his evil henchmen, they think that everything's over. They think these 3 guys are gone. They're history. They're toast. They're done. And then all of a sudden, Nebuchadnezzar notices four people. Now, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they can't get over what's going on. They have to be having a party in there. They're singing, "We didn't start the fire." Hey, they're going crazy in there. They're doing cheers. Maybe they're doing cheers, okay? Let's get fired up. So they're going through all this while these people are just staring. I don't know. That's a loose paraphrase, okay? That's probably not in your ESV version, but might be in another one somewhere. But they're going crazy in there. The ropes have been burned up. Now they can move around, but nothing has happened to them. Look at verse 26 in your Bible. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the door of the burning fiery furnace. He declared, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." Now, if I had been in the fiery furnace, I know what I would have done. I would have said, "Oh, king, we cannot hear thee. Move closer to the furnace." You know? I'm sorry. But fortunately, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were not like me, right? And so they come out of the furnace. These three friends leave behind the Son of God, and they come out of the furnace. And the Bible says that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was there a hair of their head singed. Their ropes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. When God steps in, he does not mess around. And since the king had a front row seat to this miracle, he completely changes his tune. And he says, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants." Now get ready, because this next verse, I'm just telling you, it's gonna blow you away. Because you remember the decree that was made that said, "Hey, you need to bow down to this golden statue." It's going to be totally changed. The king's going to do a 180. Look in your Bible at verse 29. "Therefore, I make a decree. Any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb and their houses laid in ruins, for there is no other God who is able to rescue in this way." Wow. You talk about a transformation. You talk about a change. This is unbelievable. He says, if you don't worship that God, and if you say anything against their God, we're going to kill you. We're going to cut you into little pieces, and then we're going to tear your house down. Now, that's a little overkill. I don't know about you. If you kill me, I don't give a rip what you do to my house after that, right? But that's what he says. He's just going on a tirade. He's making certain of it. I don't know this for a fact, but my guess is that Craigslist in Babylon that afternoon had a posting that said, "For sale, 90-foot statue, slightly used, make offer." And Nebuchadnezzar reversed a decree for an entire nation, not because of the efforts of a powerful lobby, not because of a vocal media, not because of a protest march, not because of a majority vote. The king changed his mind and his decree because of the bold, uncompromising faith of three young men who stood together in the face of death. What could you and a couple of your neighbors do in your area? What could you and a couple of Christians in your workplace do? What could you and a couple of committed Christians do at your campus for Christ? To say, we will stay the course. We will take a stand for the one true living God. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you as though something strange were happening to you." Look at that verse. Fiery trial. This is in the New Testament. I just think it's so cool that that's the wording that Peter chooses. He says, if you're sincere about your faith, you got to expect persecution. And Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, he says, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." You say, well, Dave, you keep talking about these people being saved from the fire, these three people being miraculously saved by the fire. But God doesn't always miraculously intervene and defy the laws of nature. So you should say, Dave, if you're saved from the fire, you should give glory to God. And I understand that line of thinking. I really do. But don't limit the term saved to something that is simply physical, because it can also mean something spiritual. It can also mean something eternal. I love the way Bible teacher Beth Moore says that there are three different scenarios when we face trials. One is we can be delivered from the fire and our faith is built. We can be delivered, secondly, through the fire and our faith is refined. Or thirdly, we can be delivered by the fire into his arms and our faith is perfected. And that makes a lot of sense to me. And as I share those, you can probably think of different seasons in your life when you've been in different ones of those three. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 18, Paul says, "The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom." Please realize, rarely does God intervene in miraculous fashion and dramatically save the day. That is not the rule, that is the exception. But before we conclude, I need to point something out to you. When we worked our way through this passage in Daniel chapter 3, I intentionally skipped something. I skipped the highlight of Daniel chapter 3. And you're like, no, you didn't. Three guys thrown into a fiery furnace, and they walked out and lived to tell about it. That's the highlight. No, that's not the highlight. The highlight in Daniel chapter 3 is found in verses 16 through 18. That's the highlight of the chapter. This is before they're thrown in the furnace. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, we will not serve your gods. We will not worship the image of gold that you have set up." And so as they stand before the king, I find it interesting that when they say the God we serve is able to save us, that the word that they choose, the name for God that they chose in that moment is the name El Elyon. You know what that means? The God who is in control. They trust that God is in control. Our God is able to save us if he chooses. But even if he chooses not to, we're still going to serve him. We're still going to choose him. We trust the God that's in control. He will be faithful. And so they trust him however he decides. And we don't know how this is going to turn out, they're saying. But we trust him. In other words, they're saying, Nebuchadnezzar, you might be the king of the land, but there is one who is a higher authority than you. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. And someday when we stand before him, we will be glad that we did not bow before you. Here's the final lesson. We stand regardless. Our God can take us to the mountaintop, but sometimes he allows us to spend time in the valley. But he's deepening us, and the soil is rich there in the valley. That's where the most growth occurs. And it's in those, oh, that's bad moments, more so than in the, oh, that's good seasons. You know that life was filled with ups and downs for Jesus too. Thousands flocking to him to hear his message. Oh, that's good. Leaders secretly plotting to kill him. Oh, that's bad. Giving time to the overlooked and the hurting. Oh, that's good. But then came the cross, and we're quick to say, oh, that's bad. But without the cross, we have no hope. And we realize that it is only through Jesus' sacrifice that our sins could be paid for. So now from our perspective, we realize that the cross is good. We even call it Good Friday. Think of it like this. The worst thing that ever happened to Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to you. Without the cross, we have no hope. And we trust that he can still do that, that he can take what Satan intends for evil and he can bring good out of it, and he can do it in your life. He can do it in your church. He can give hope when you think of the situation as hopeless. As I've worked on this message all week, I got to tell you, I have tried to put myself in your shoes. And that's not easy. I'm just a guy who lives 350 miles away who is praying and pulling for your church to deepen through all of the questions and accusations and turmoil. I pray for more haystacks than pitchforks in the days ahead for you. And I realize that many of you would just love to go back 6 months ago, or you'd love to go back 10 years ago, when walking into worship had less drama, or when watching the evening news didn't make you feel like your church resembled a reality TV show. And I know you'd like for the drama to dissipate and for things to just go back to normal. But what if God doesn't want harvest to be normal? What if God needs to make some adjustments in order for harvest to be able to reach its full potential? And he just wants the leaders and he just wants the members to be teachable. What if God doesn't want you to become just another normal, go through the motions church? What if he has a bigger plan for harvest? And what if in this season he wants to correct and deepen? He wants to refine and renew this church and each and every one of us. Look, I don't know what the future holds for harvest. You all realize you don't know what might happen tomorrow. We don't know what twists and turns there might be. Who knows? God only knows. I'm encouraged by things that have happened in this last week. But I'll tell you, I don't know all of the ups and downs that will unfold in the days to come. All of the, oh, that's good, and oh, that's bad moments. But here's what I do know. I know that if the members are patiently and passionately seeking truth more than gossip, and unity more than factions, and if this church is truly rooted in God's word, and if the leaders are humbly seeking to honor God, and if this church is built on the foundation of Jesus Christ being the Son of the living God, if that's your foundation, then you can rest assured the gates of hell will not prevail against it. They can't. He rebuilds. He restores. He redeems. That's who he is. That's what he does. So let him do his work in your church. And more importantly than that, let him do his work in you. Because he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. Let's pray. Lord, we take comfort in knowing that only three men walked out of the fire, and that the other one, whom we believe to have been the Christ, remained there to comfort us when we go through our fiery trials. Thank you for Jesus, who specializes in turning, oh, that's bad moments, into, oh, that's good seasons. And may the example of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego motivate us to stand, and to stand boldly, regardless of the earthly consequences. It's in the powerful name of Jesus Christ that we pray. And all God's people said, amen.